in that first book of your Bible, Genesis, the 23rd chapter. We'll be reading the chapter. Sarah lived 127 years. These were the years of the life of Sarah. And Sarah died at Kiriath Arab, that is Hebron, in the land of Canaan. And Abraham went in to mourn for Sarah and to weep for her. And Abraham rose up from before his dead and said to the Hittites, I am a sojourner and a foreigner among you. Give me property among you for a burying place, that I may bury my dead out of my sight. The Hittites answered Abraham, Hear us, my lord. You are a prince of God among us. Bury your dead in the choicest of tombs. None of us will withhold from you his tomb to hinder you from burying your dead. Abraham rose and bowed to the Hittites, the people of the land. And he said to them, If you are willing that I should bury my dead out of my sight, hear me and entreat for me Ephron, the son of Zohar, that he may give me the cave of Machpelah, which he owns. It is at the end of his field. For the full price, let him give it to me in your presence as property for a burying place. Now Ephron was sitting among the Hittites, and Ephron the Hittite answered Abraham in the hearing of the Hittites of all who went in and out of the gate of the city, No, my lord, hear me. I give you the field, and I give you the cave that is in it. In the sight of the sons of my people, I give it to you. Bury your dead. Then Abraham bowed down before the people of the land, and he said to Ephron in the hearing of the people of the land, But if you will, hear me. I give the price of the field. Accept it from me, that I may bury my dead. Ephron answered Abraham, My lord, listen to me. A piece of land worth 400 shekels of silver. What is that between you and me? Bury your dead. Abraham listened to Ephron, and Abraham weighed out for Ephron the silver that he had named in the hearing of the Hittites, 400 shekels of silver, according to the weights current among the merchants. So the field of Ephron in Machpelah, which was to the east of Mamre, the field with the cave that was in it, and all the trees that were in the field, throughout its whole area was made over to Abraham as a possession in the presence of the Hittites before all who went in at the gate of his city. After this, Abraham buried Sarah, his wife, in the cave and the field of Machpelah, east of Mamre, that is Hebron, in the land of Canaan. The field and the cave that is in it were made over to Abraham as property for a burying place by the Hittites. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let's go to our Lord in a word of prayer. We pray. Father in heaven, we thank you this day for giving us all our gifts and abilities, for showering upon us a place here to worship, for giving us each other as a community of faith, a family of faith, for blessing us, Lord, in soul and body. And we ask you, Lord, that we might truly have thankful hearts, not only in this, the month of Thanksgiving, not only in the upcoming Thanksgiving celebration, but every day as we worship you. Help us to see, Lord, that your table here today, your altar, has the Thanksgiving meal on it, the Eucharist, a holy Thanksgiving meal, which we give thanks for as it gives us the forgiveness of sins and the hope of life everlasting. Now, Lord, we ask you to open your scriptures to us, that we might see how you have spent yourself for us. We pray it in Christ. Amen. So we have been studying here throughout these last weeks, the last couple of weeks, the month of Thanksgiving. And I brought with me my piggy bank, and you can see it here on the screen. My piggy bank has a unique feature that it has three openings. It has an opening for sharing, so we spent a week talking about sharing. It has an opening for saving, and we spent last week learning about saving as we learned about the Jubilee year. And now we're learning about spending, maybe our favorite of the three options. But in order to understand all three of those in a godly way, we need to begin by understanding that all gifts belong to the Lord. The Bible tells us the silver is mine and the gold is mine, declares the Lord. The book of Haggai makes that clear. And again, we learned last week in the book of Leviticus, the land shall not be sold in perpetuity, for the land is mine. And today, we're hearing about the very first owning of land that was by Abraham in the promised land. So we will follow this brief outline. We will learn about Abraham's spending habits, as we just read about them. We will consider God's own spending habits, and then we will turn attention to our own spending habits. So where did Abraham get all this wealth that God bestowed upon them? Abraham shared the wealth that God provided to him to a priest called Melchizedek. We read about it in Genesis 14. Abraham understood that at the top of his piggy bank was sharing. And Melchizedek, that is king of Salem, or as you would know it, Jerusalem, brought out bread and wine. He was a priest of God Most High, and he blessed him, Abraham. And Abraham gave a tenth of everything. But Abraham was blessed to be able to do such a great gift to Melchizedek because God showered gifts upon him in an unusual way. Let's learn about it in Genesis chapter 12. As Pharaoh, king of Egypt, blesses Abraham with great wealth. The orange words are for you to read out loud. And Abraham took Sarai his wife and Lot his brother's son and all their possessions that they had gathered and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. So they already had quite a few possessions before they ever got to the promised land. And again in Genesis 12, and for her sake he dealt well with Abram, and he had sheep and oxen, male donkeys and camels. That is, Pharaoh dealt well with Abraham because Pharaoh was trying to take Abraham's wife. Kind of unusual way to get wealth. Let's read more about how Abraham received silver and gold. Abraham was a wealthy man. We read about it in chapter 13. So Abram went up from Egypt, he and his wife and all that he had, and Lot with him, into the Negev. Now Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver, and in gold. He had some when he came from Haran. He had some given to him by Pharaoh. And here again, he's blessed yet more. We learn that Abraham not only had livestock, he had money. We read it in Genesis 17. He who is 8 days old among you shall be circumcised, every male throughout your generations, whether born in your house or bought with your money, from any foreigner who is not of your offspring. Now, we're not used to people buying people, and we're not advocating people buy people, but that was the case and one use of the money at the time of Abram. Genesis 17 also, both he who is born in your house and he who is bought with your money shall surely be circumcised. Here, we're not so much speaking about slavery. Here, we're talking about our possessions. And Abram had money, is the point. Abram also earned money by again presenting his wife Sarai, not this time to the king of Egypt, Pharaoh, but to Abimelech, another king. We read about it. And Abraham said to Sarah, his wife, she is my sister. And Abimelech, king of Gerar, sent and took Sarah. To Sarah, he said, behold, I have given your brother 1,000 pieces of silver. Wow, this guy's making out pretty good, isn't he? So Abraham took sheep and oxen and gave them to Abimelech, and the two made a covenant. These 7 ewe lambs you will take from my hand, that this may be a witness for me that I dug this well. I think this is the very, very, very first land in the promised land, but there doesn't seem to be an exchange other than animals. So when we're looking for that first spending of Abraham, this might be it, this well which exists to today, the well of Beersheba. This might have been his first property, or is it this burial site? We read about this in today's text. Sarah lived 127 years. And Sarah died in Kiriath Arba, that is Hebron, in the land of Canaan. That is, he gave the cave of Machpelah for the full price he bought it. So what did God spend, though? We have learned about Abraham's spending, but God spent some of his wealth on Abraham. And among these same texts that we're just reading about, all the wealth of Abraham and how he spent his wealth, we also learn about this in Genesis 15. We learn that God spent land on Abraham. I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to possess. How did he get the land? God gave it to him. Even though Abraham was doling out 400 pieces of silver, the Bible still believes God's the giver of the gift. So when you're spending some money, don't get confused and thinking that you're the source of that blessing. God's the giver of all good things, even when you put out your money for it. Again, in Genesis 15, what did God spend in order to bless Abraham? A smoking fire pot and a flaming torch passed between the pieces. Basically, they had a butcher shop there, and that's what they passed in between, pieces of beef. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, to your offspring I give this land. So land was spent by God. God considered the land his own. He was giving it into Abraham's possession. And God spent blood. Blood to make a covenant with Abraham. So let's look into God's spending habits beyond Abraham. We learn that God gave what and to whom. We read in John 14, let not your heart be troubled. Believe in God, Jesus says. Believe so also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you, and I will come back again and will take you to myself. What did God already spend on each and every one of us here today? He spent preparation. He's prepared a room for you in heaven. He's already made the expense. He's already spent himself on you. It's already prepared. In addition to a room, what else has God spent on you? We read about it in Romans 3. You are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as a propitiation by his blood, be received by faith. Wow, redemption, propitiation. What are those big words meaning? Redemption means this, the Greek apolutrosis, a related term means to buy back a slave or a captive, to set someone free. You were purchased by God. He spent his lifeblood to buy you. Just like Abraham had people he bought, God has people he bought. You're one of them. You are a doulos, a servant of the Lord. He bought you. That's how God chooses to spend himself. He spends his wealth on you. Let's learn about propitiation. What does that mean? Christ's death is classified as propitiatory since it is a work of satisfaction for guilt and punishment that reconciles God and placates his wrath and merits our forgiveness of sins and forgiveness of sins for others. Propitiation is the way that we get access to that room God has prepared for us in heaven. God spends himself on us, and he spends himself by the lifeblood of his son, Jesus Christ. The Bible's very clear about this. We read it in the book of Hebrews. By his own blood, he entered it once for all into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption, payback, for us. How did he buy us? With his blood. He spent his life on us. Again, in 1 John, he is the propitiation for our sins, and not for our own sins only, but also for the sins of mankind. God spent himself for us and for everyone else outside those doors. Having understood a little bit about how Abraham spent the wealth God presented to him, and understanding a little bit about how God spent the wealth that is available to him, namely on us, how ought we do that last function on our piggy banks? That spending function. Here we are getting ready for the greatest spending rush in the yearly cycle in the United States of America. What do they call that day after Thanksgiving? Black Friday. Which one's better known, Black Friday or Good Friday? Probably Black Friday, I'm with you, yes. And why is that? How ought we go about spending? Maybe we should check our hearts a little bit before we go spending. Are we trying to buy love? Today, before you get married, I hear people say, we're not going to get married yet, Pastor. I say, well, why not? Because I don't have money for the ring. Well, how much money do you think you need for the ring? Oh, about $10,000, $20,000. $10,000 or $20,000? What do you think's going on when you give the lady a ring? You think you're buying her? Buying her love? We're greatly confused. Well, what about when we go to the mall? We're going to buy all kinds of things. Here, buy anything you want. You're my girlfriend. I'm going to buy you everything you want in the mall. Why are you going to do that? Because I'm trying to buy your affection. Apparently, we think money buys love. That is sinful. That is not God's will for our lives. Money is not supposed to buy people's love. But I'm afraid that's why we know Black Friday better than we know Good Friday. What else has attempted to be bought in our world? We just had an election. They spent millions, if not billions of dollars for the positions that people were elected to. It's a very expensive thing, a campaign. And so we hear these people are marching caution, okay, that the bribe coming through. Could it be in our America that people would bribe each other? Yes. And what do we think of our elected officers if they don't come back with the money from the federal government? They don't bring our federal tax dollars back home, we fire them. It's about money. Money buys votes. What kind of culture do we live in? The kind of culture that tries to buy love? The kind of culture that tries to buy votes? What else do we try to buy? What about our friends? Remember Richie Rich? I'm old enough to remember Richie Rich. Does anyone else remember him? I think they made him into a movie. Richie Rich was very tempted. He had the big house. He had all the fabulous wealth, but he didn't always have a lot of friends, and it was very tempting for him to try to buy his friends, and many times he was very disappointed because friends cannot be bought, not true friends. What kind of world are we living in when we think that our spending is how we make love, our spending is how we make government, our spending is how we make friendships? How do things happen in your own household? Here, Jackie did a wonderful job again with our children's message, explaining to us she was going to go spend 15 whole cents on her family per person for Christmas gifts. She had the Christmas wish list covered. How does that work in your house? Do children give wish lists, or do they give you ransom lists? I'm going to ransom my love for you until you deliver the big Christmas gift to me. And when you do deliver what I put on the list, then I will give you hugs and affection. But if you do not deliver what I put on my wish list or ransom list, you will receive no hugs and affection. Rather, you will receive a temper tantrum and a scene. I'm afraid families, many of whom are divided, the moms and dads are trying to make Christmas who's the best mom, who's the best dad. And the kids use the leverage. And they play the parents off each other. They're getting people to spend money to buy affection. Am I making this stuff up? No, this is real. This is real. This is the culture in which we live. So how do we come to spending? It's terribly confused with our social life. Rather, we're to see that God has spent everything on us, and that our spending is not to buy people or buy their love or buy their friendship or buy their vote. Rather, our spending is to glorify God. Our sharing is to glorify God. Our saving is to glorify God. It's all about glorifying God. Now, if you'd like to participate today, you don't have to, but there is a discipline that we are using here. And this discipline we have used for several years to assist our own selves is the discipline of a stewardship covenant. And that stewardship covenant has been handed out to you. If you're not prepared to do this today, take it home with you and pray about it and bring it back. That'll be fine. So Amy and I have discussed this, this little sheet. We filled it out. We put in there how we're going to pray this year. How are we going to share the gospel this year? How are we going to live our life in our congregation and before the Lord this year? How are we going to give this year? And none of you need to know. I'm putting it in this envelope. I'm inviting you to do the same. I'm licking my envelope. It's hard to talk while you lick. And that's then my name and Amy's name's on here, and I'm putting it here in this stewardship covenant box. All these items are also available in the back there. You can put it in there. You could just hand it to one of the elders, hand it to me if you want to. You can mail it back to us if you want to, if that's how you want to do it. These are all put together and put into our safe, and next year we hand them back to you for your consideration. We do not set our budget upon these. They are sealed, and I never see them, and no one else ever sees them. Because this discipline about sharing gifts with God and saving gifts for God and spending gifts for God is a discipline between you and God. And so we invite you to this simply for your own benefit and your own self-discipline. As you come forward for Holy Communion, you could put them right in here, or as you leave today, you can put them in right there. We ask that God would take all of these dedicated gifts and use them in a godly way that we can have more than just a month of Thanksgiving. We can have a thankful life now and eternally. Would you pray with me? I'm going to pray with my hands right on this stewardship covenant box that everyone would know that we're here dedicating this to our Lord, we pray. Father in heaven, we thank you this day for sharing all your gifts with us. All the gold, all the silver is yours. All the land is yours. Not just the promised land, all the land. Everything that we have and are comes from you. And you have spent yourself greatly on us. You are the wealthiest one amongst us. And you've spent even the lifeblood of your own Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, that we might know this redemption of our sins, that we have been propitiated for, that we have a room in heaven prepared for us by grace in Christ. All of this spending, we simply say, thank you. Thank you to you, dear Lord, for all your gracious gifts to us. And now as we bring forward our stewardship covenants, we ask that our relationship with you would ever grow in all its facets until that day we occupy that room you have prepared for us so generously. Now we commend ourselves to you this day in Christ. Amen. We invite you to stand as we respond to God's gospel message with the ancient words of the Nicene Creed, written in 381 AD. This is a discipline to help us remember what we share in faith.